tuning in to Written on the Edge, Season 7, Episode 22. I'm Ben Sebastian here with my co-host, S.A. Baz Collins.
Hello.
And we're really glad you're here with us. On today's show, Marcus James joins us to discuss his book, Where the Vile Things Are, followed by our review or look at queer representation in Star Trek. Then Baz and I will discuss what's held our attention this week. So if you like what we're doing, support us on Patreon, hit our merch store, give us a like, you know, the usuals. Now on to our guest. Marcus James has been writing since the age of 5. At 17, he finished his first novel, and at 19, he was signed with his first literary agent. He's been published in a dozen anthologies and has published 9 of his own novels, all of them varied and wonderful, filled with complex and engrossing people. Marcus's experience with conversion therapy at the age of 14 led to a lifelong activism for LGBTQ rights and sharing his story to help end clinical conversion therapy in the state of Washington. He's a horror fanatic and loves to cook. Marcus loves his pets, history, music, and live shows, and drinking champagne till he can't take the bubbles anymore. Through his novels, he hopes to always show that everyone can be a hero, everyone can save the world, even a femme gay boy with the swish in his step. Marcus, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you again. Thank you for having me.
That's quite the varied bio.
Yeah. I've had a varied life.
Sounds like several.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, the main constant through all of that is I'm a novelist, and that's, you don't choose that. It's the vocation. It's not.
Chooses you. Yep.
But sometimes you do have to do other stuff while doing that to make that work. So I have done a lot of things.
So I know starting at age 5, the memories may be hazy, but do you remember what sparked the interest in writing that first story?
Oh, God. Let's see. So at the age of 5, oh, so taking it far back. At the age of 5, the only one that really stands out for me at the age of 5 is there's one story that I did. I had a very active imagination. At the time, though, I did more acting things out, I guess, than I guess attempting to write or tell a story. But I was very much an active storyteller. Mm-hmm. I just had a very fertile imagination. But one of the first things I actually attempted to write was a story about a leprechaun and a vampire. And I was...
Because you know.
Right. I mean, I was really into leprechauns. I mean, Darby O'Gill and the Little People is still one of the best movies in the entire world.
Oh, I remember that movie.
Yeah, I still watch it every St. Patrick's Day. It's
nice.
It's a magical thing.
Nice.
And then, of course, I was just really obsessed my whole life with vampires. Probably, I mean, since preschool. So I started preschool about 3 and a half. And about that time was Count Duckula was on television. And,
oh, God.
Great cartoon from England. And obviously the Count from Sesame Street. And then my mom was a young mom. And the family that surrounded us, we all kind of lived within a few blocks of each other. Mm-hmm. And this is back in Bellingham, Washington, where most of my books take place, actually. Yeah, most of my books all take place in Bellingham.
A good part of my family lives there, so.
Oh, great, yeah. My family's been there for freaking ages. Ages and ages. We're dusty, musty Bellingham. And so I write a lot about, I mean, that's pretty much all I write about is Bellingham, and the history of Bellingham is in all of my novels, and cool, fun societal facts about it or how things used to be, whatever. And plus the plethora of ghost stories, because there's ghosts around every corner in Bellingham. Which people don't realize, because it's the city of subdued excitement, and it's not and it's been financially struggling for so long that it's so on the tip of the world, and it didn't become Seattle. It was originally Bellingham and Tacoma, where I now live, were kind of both slated to be Seattle before Seattle became Seattle. And then Seattle just happened to luck out and get all the development
good PR.
The railroad picked it as its base. And so it became this big thing. But like New Orleans, like Savannah, like other cities that are overflowingly, reputedly haunted and famous for that, Bellingham is just as crowded and has just as many ghost stories. And I wish that the tourism and stuff came to Bellingham in such a way that they could really cash in on that, you know, and do tours, ghost tours, walking tours, things like that. But unfortunately, being where it is. Anyway, I digress. So that is where, so being from there, and my family being so cloistered, my relatives, like my aunts, my uncles, they were all relatively my mom's age. My Aunt Lisa was, who's my mom's younger sister, when I was born, she was 14. My Uncle Terry was in his 20s. So, and then my cousins were in high school. And so it was a lot of young people hanging out every day. So at a very young age, you have things in the 80s. What were young people doing? They were renting horror movies from the video store and putting them in the VHS and the Betamax. And so I grew up, and I started a very young age with horror. And vampires, I just fell in love with them from the get-go. There's just, there was something about them that out of all the things, out of all the witches and vampires, just like grabbed me as a very young boy. And that was my obsession. So I wrote a story in kindergarten about a leprechaun and a vampire who were best friends, and a banshee was trying to steal the leprechaun's gold, and the leprechaun couldn't like defend itself really, or like whatever, at night. I don't know. I was fine. And so the vampire would keep guard at night and like protect the leprechaun and his gold. It made absolutely no sense, but it was my thing.
Well,
and so that was kind of my first like real memory of writing something and feeling like kind of like a connection to it. But that still wasn't like what I guess that wasn't what originally I thought I was going to be. I started out originally as a little boy thinking I was going to be an actor because I was a Leo. I loved acting. I fought like a vicious B-I-T-C-H to get the lead role of the Little Red Hen in my kindergarten play. It's a lady's role. And I got several. I didn't care. I was 5 years old and I was like, boy or girl, I want the lead.
Nice.
So I thought that's what I was going to do. And then, but that just, it just wasn't, it didn't work out in terms of it. I didn't have a passion to pursue it. And then I discovered cooking, and from a very early age, I think it was maybe seven, and it was just the PBS cooking shows because there was no Food Network at the time, and I just suddenly wanted to be a chef. And so I had this lofty idea that I was going to go to culinary. I was going to go to the Culinary Institute of America. From there, go to Le Cordon Bleu. And then I was going to have two restaurants in downtown Seattle. And I was going to have a cooking show on PBS. And I was going to have a great apartment of living above Pike Place Market, where I would go shopping every day for myself and my restaurant. Keep in mind, I'm like between seven and nine at this point. And I had it all. I was just pragmatic Leo. I was like, even at seven, I was like, this is going to be my life as an adult.
I love it.
Because then the writing happens. So.
Right. Let me ask you here. How does this tie into your latest release? When you're talking about all of these subject matters, it's really... because, you know, obviously in the title of your book, you're addressing some of these topics. So how did all of that culminate in what you have out now? And if you want to show people the cover of your book so people can see it.
So this is Where the Vile Things Are, A Study in Sex, Revenge, Deceit, and Affluenza. The cover is like candy. It's like electric neon candy. And it is a modern retelling of Les Liaisons, St. Drew, Dangerous Liaisons, or as most people actually know it, the film Cruel Intentions with Ryan Phillippe and Sarah Michelle Gellar that came out in 1999. That is just an adaptation of the same novel. And that was actually the first film, when that film came out, it was the first thing to give me that idea that, oh, I could tell this story in a modern way. And that became my years-long goal, was to write this book. Wrote a lot of stuff in between, but finally was able to get this one together. And basically, it's still the same story, except I didn't want to tell the same battle of the sexes story that it's always been. It's men, women versus each other, and patriarchy and matriarchy and oppression within the embodiment of Mertoy and Valmont. And I, as a femme gay boy growing up in this world and also within our own community, dealing with that kind of built in homophobia from our own people when it comes to, especially from butch gay men or butch presenting mask gay men to femme gay boys or gay men and gay boys. There's this, it's not great. We're called that we're an embarrassment. It's not good. And I wanted to tell that story. I wanted to take this battle between kind of this internalized homophobia within our own community of, in this kind of hetero worship that has caused that we have this, you know, no femmes thing and everything else. And why is that? And how society as a whole, the heterosexual society, how they treat femme gay men and gay men in general, especially. And why? I really wanted to get to exploring the roots of heterosexism in our society and how that poisons so many things. And I also wanted to tackle subjects like the alt-right, alt-light, young conservative movement that started with Trump, and which unfortunately we have some, we have some queers on that side, which is really disappointing.
Girl, don't get me started.
So from all of that came Oliver Mertoy and Nathan Valmont. And Oliver just, I don't know, he kind of came an avenging archangel. His drive, whereas the Marquise de Mertoy, she wanted to be the avenging angel, the force of reckoning for women in society. By destroying all these men who think they can get away with whatever. Oliver wanted to become the avenger for all the little gays like him with a swish in their step and who aren't super butch and who, you know, they're infantilized and talked down to by both, you know, gay men, butch gay men and straight men and straight women and straight people in general. And the being treated as almost like a eunuch, like a toy for a lot of straight women a lot of times. And we're kind of treated very sexless and neutered. And we're boys, but we're not the same. We're like the girls, you know, and just all that stuff that we don't even see and realize how much it is actually shapes us and is damaging as we grow up. And we take it in and we don't even realize how demeaning it is until one day we get older and it strikes us. And we're like, oh, I don't like that. And I wanted, and I saw in Oliver a chance to kind of address that. Plus, I just always wanted to write the dangerous liaisons. And I like the idea of these kind of vapid, I mean, not vapid, but very, very kind of self-centered, privileged people who live in this kind of opulence of San Francisco. And they're kind of a representation of a time kind of before 2015, 2016, before we super split down our middle into our tribes and really started kind of warring with each other. Mertoy and Valmont in my novel kind of represent that, the older way of kind of how things used to be where, I mean, there was still crap in the world and we still got angry about things, but we weren't trying to cancel everything. We weren't getting angry and upset about every little thing. Cause it seems like you're in this time now. And I see it a lot where it's like, you can't win no matter what you do, because right, someone's gonna be like, well, you forgot this, you left this out, and as a result, we're just always fighting with each other. And I kind of there is that party that's like, I do remember, like, things weren't great. I mean, things weren't, we had awful comedians, misogynistic comedians back in the day and everything else, still do. But they're now, of course, getting called out for it and everything, which back then we didn't have. But at the same time, we weren't getting angry about everything.
Right.
And fighting about every little thing all the time. And since, you know, things
don't go to social media.
Exactly. And so I needed to have two characters who, you know, if anyone's familiar with The Dangerous Liaisons or the film Cruel Intentions, then Murtoy and Valmont don't have the best ending. So I felt they were a prime example as a metaphor for a time that is done. Mm-hmm. As well, that when the book comes to an end, they take that era with them. Right. And I thought that was kind of, so it made it safe to kind of use them as kind of a lens to of commentary on certain things that I hope will put readers into some kind of perspective and go, you know, I didn't think about that, you know,
So one of the things I know that a lot of current authors are struggling with is how to use and integrate technology into their stories, because technology can foil a lot of plots.
Yeah.
It sounds like, because the original novel is all told through letters, it sounds like in your case, technology and texting and email enhances the story.
Yeah. So I tried writing this book in a lot of different ways throughout the years, through the past 20 something years, because the first time I attempted to even write this, I was like 14 or 15. Mm-hmm. And I used to always just do the omniscient third person. That's usually how I write. Mm-hmm. And I kept trying to write the book that way, and it just wasn't working. And then January 6th happened and shook me to my core. And that's when Oliver Murtoy and Nathan Valmont walked back into the room, realized like never before, and they looked at me. I was gonna sound really esoteric, sidebar, but side note. I feel like a clairvoyant. It's the only way I can describe it. Tori Amos has a girl.
All good writers do.
Yeah, I have my boys. I call them my boys, and I'm tapping into somewhere. So they walked in and they just said, do the novel. They just said, open up the book, go letter by letter. Just read through it, sit back, and then let us tell you how it has happened now. And so that's what I did. I propped the book up and I started with the editor's preface, and I just went page after page. And my book, while you could open up every letter and be like, and then compare it to the messages in my book, and you'd be like, oh yeah, it's basically the same. They're also very, very different. In my book, I've cut some letters out and replaced them with my own. Mm-hmm. But in order to make that happen, I was like, no one writes letters anymore.
Right.
So then I thought, how can I do this? And I was like, we all DM now. Most people don't even text. Most people DM each other. Even if they have each other's phone numbers to text, people get on like Instagram Messenger to message each other, even though they can text each other. It's weird. So I just thought, okay, let's use emails. Let's use direct message. Let's use texting. And we'll use that as our vehicle to tell this story. This is how we all communicate now. Mm-hmm. I need to keep it epistolary. The beauty of that, if people don't know, epistolary is a collection of letters or journals or whatever that make up a book, an epistolary novel. And in the original epistle, the reason it works is because we hear and see how, but with Valmont and Murtoy, with their victims writing to them and interacting with them, we hear one voice. And then when they're talking to each other, writing to each other, we hear a different voice completely. And it's chilling how they switch like that, chameleon-like. And so that's why it was really important to keep it the way it was, because I wanted, as people read it and go through all the different messages, I wanted people to really hear and feel that unsettling switch, about how their voices are just changing and they're altering for the Cecile Valange and Stephen Torvell, who are their chosen targets that they've placed their wager on, to, you know, bed them and publicly humiliate them. And as a reward, if Nathan Valmont can ruin both these, sleep with both these people, Cecile Valange and Stephen Torvell, then Oliver will sleep with Nathan, which is something that, because they're so tangled up in each other and it's so toxic, that is all Nathan Valmont can really desire or think about. So, it played a huge part. It was the only way to tell the story was technology. It's the world we live in, so there was no way around it.
Right. So I know we're coming close to our time here.
We
still have some get-to-know-you questions to ask. So what else do you want folks to know about the novel?
I want, most first and foremost, I want people to know that it's a fun read. It's just a fun read. It's there are, as it says in the novel, there are no heroes. As in life, everyone is basically morally flawed or morally bankrupt, which we're all in life. Either we're morally flawed people who don't always do the right thing, or there are morally bankrupt people in the world who are just vicious and don't care. It's just a fun read. If you love kind of revengey stories, if you love darker tales of love and romance, if you were a fan of Cruel Intentions, honestly, if you were a fan of Cruel Intentions or The Dangerous Liaisons, then, I mean, this is the book. This is the book for you. If you love, you know, kind of decadence and ridiculousness and dark humor, this is the book. This is the book for you.
And folks can pick it up everywhere fine books are sold.
Yeah. So Where Vile Things Are is available online and brick and mortar, any and all bookstores, both digital on ebook and in paperback.
And if they come to your site, they get a signed copy?
Correct. If they come to if you come to marcusjamesbooks.com, then you can either, you know, obviously order just the regular copy, and there's a link to that. But there's also a link to order a signed, personalized copy from me, so they can go and can do that. And I get those out real quick. I'm a big, big fan of signing and sending, and because, you know, it's exciting.
That's
and
awesome.
I appreciate every reader and always have. So anyone who ever wants to get a book, I'm like, yes, I got it in the mail to you.
Perfect. What's up next for you?
I think because it's always still up in the air and getting finalized, I believe I have a few or a couple convention events coming up in the fall. And right now I'm working on my latest novel titled Renfield Syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
And I will just say that it is meant to be I don't want to say direct sequel because that's not the right term because it takes place a century or so later, but I guess kind of in a way a direct sequel to Dracula.
Nice.
But
well,
also
if you're dealing with Dracula, but when you're dealing with Dracula, 100 years is a sequel. You
know? Yeah, well, exactly. And, but
time is irrelevant.
It's also very, very queer.
Obviously. Okay.
I'm not going to get away from that.
Okay.
Good.
Yeah,
good.
So that's where it's at. It's just following some descendants and it's continuing the Dracula story through the character of R.M. Renfield. And I'm super excited about it. And just ready to enjoy summer. And that's about all I have going for me.
All right. Well, what social is the best for people to follow you to get these updates?
My Facebook, which is, what is my Facebook handle? Hold on, I'm going to find out.
M. James Writer. I'm looking at it.
What is it? Oh, yeah. Basically, M, capital J, Writer. So M. James Writer with the capital M and J. And then my Instagram, which I'm on the most, is just Marcus James Author.
Perfect.
So.
All right. All right. Any final words of wisdom?
Shaboom.
Because awesome. Why not?
Because why not?
Because shaboom.
Exactly. Because shaboom. No, if I really wanted a final message, it would just be no matter what people tell you, no matter the opposition or the naysayers, don't listen to any of them. If you have a passion, if there's something you want to do or dream of doing, and you know that that is what it is, whether it's in being a, you know, in social activism or a writer or a visual artist or whatever, a lawyer, if you feel that is your calling, just stick to your guns and do it and never give up. And it's not always easy. It can be a hard struggle, but it's worth it.
Perfect.
Amen.
All right, folks, we'd like to extend a huge thank you to Marcus James for being with us. Marcus, thank you so much.
Thank you.
We at Written on the Edge are proud to introduce you to media by new queer content creators. If you enjoy learning about new artists, please like and subscribe so you get the alerts for new episodes. And if you want to hear this full interview, check out our Patreon. Stay tuned for our look at queer themes in Star Trek.
Everybody, welcome back to the show. Today we've got something slightly different for the review segment. In this case, we're talking about the queer representation within the realm of Star Trek. And this, we're going to talk about all of the shows that are out currently and ones in the past, so that we kind of cover the evolution, or in some cases, devolution of queer representation within the Star Trek universe.
Now, we do have to clarify that this is on screen only. We're not talking about the novels, officially sanctioned or otherwise. We are literally just talking about screens.
Yes, TV shows and movies. So we're going to kind of break it down chronologically, talk about each one of the shows and our overall impressions of queer representation within the shows as they evolved over time. And then we may do a little hopping around to make points about, you know, where we are currently with, which we universally have to acknowledge we are in a much better place now than we ever have been. So right out the gate, you know, but there's also pushback on that, and we will get to that too as well. So let's start with the original series. What have you got?
I've got actually a George Takei quote that I've loved for years, because it explains why Roddenberry couldn't go there yet, but that he was trying and he was pushing as hard as he could. So the quote was from 2015 for Big Think. George Takei said, "In one episode, we had a biracial kiss. Captain Kirk and Uhura had a kiss. That show was literally blacked out in the South. Louisiana, Alabama, Mississippi, Georgia didn't air that. Our ratings plummeted. It was the lowest rated episodes that we had." And Roddenberry said, "I'm treading a fine, tight wire here. I'm dealing with the issues of the time. I'm dealing with the civil rights movement, the Vietnam War, the Cold War, and I need to be able to make that statement by staying on the air." And prior to his death in 91, Roddenberry had said that he had been wanting to include something, and he recognized he had done it poorly. But this sort of highlights what he was up against originally. Yeah, oh, and what he was up against originally. Because he pushed a lot of boundaries, even if it wasn't ours.
Right. And the thing is, you have to acknowledge that Roddenberry was a true sci-fi fan. You know, he embraced what sci-fi is truly about. And a lot of these dweeby little kids who profess to be such hardcore sci-fi fans, they only take it within the heterosexual content. They don't really see the inclusiveness. And in fact, that's been the pushback of the modern shows, is why is everything gay all of a sudden? Well, it was always meant to be from the beginning. They just couldn't do it. You know, from that, you had the motion pictures, and you had some of the recast of bringing up the cast from the original series, which only ran for 3 years. Mm-hmm. And through the conventions that happened to start, and they started getting bigger and bigger and started going around the country. When they first started, a lot of them were focused in LA because that's where all the actors were that they could get to appear easily. I ended up going to the one in 1977 in LA, which was so packed. I mean, I don't know how they pulled off that convention, because I think the fire marshals were paid under the table, because there were way too many people in that facility. And it was also the same year that as the actors were arriving for Star Wars, because that was being released that year, they had an accident with the limousine, and that's the one where Mark Hamill went through the windshield, and which is why he had the plastic surgery and all that stuff. So I was there at that that convention when all of that went down. But getting back to Star Trek, it, you know, the everything we had had, you know, and while I can understand what was going on with the series, I think it was a little bit of a problem when you start to get to the movies that they didn't address any of that.
Right.
So I have, and Roddenberry was alive then, you know, so I have some real issues with, even though he did say that and he did fight for it, but it was something that at the times it was really hard to do. Okay, we jump forward 10 years and we're at, you know, the time when Star Trek the Motion Picture was about to be released. You know, it had an opportunity to do something and it didn't. Again, you go forward to, you know, Wrath of Khan, and, you know, before we get to Next Generation, when that premiered, you had other opportunities, and that baton was never picked up. Not really. I mean, maybe in the background, extras 247 and 263 might have had something going on,
right,
but it was not front and center for us to see. You know, there wasn't even a breadcrumb to latch onto. What are your thoughts up to that point?
Again, kind of a heartbreak. I know that in 90, Roddenberry told the Galaxians that with Next Generation, which we're about to dip into, he was going to show more life of the characters on the ship, and he's going to include families, and he wanted to show some of that, even if it was in the background, he just wanted to show it as family stuff. But then he died in 91 before he was able to actually carry that promise through.
And even though Next Generation started, I think it was in 86, wasn't it, when the first one aired, or was it 88?
It might have been 88. I think it was closer to his death.
Yeah. But I call those, because Rick Berman really was running the show on a day-to-day basis. I call those show that show The Lost Years, because ample opportunity. It wasn't like gays did not have presence in the media. We had fought through the 70s and most of the 80s to establish ourselves, and there were more and more stories being told. I mean, hell, we had soap back in the 70s with
Billy Crystal
playing Jody Campbell, and you know, so you had, you know, representation already happening where they didn't die, you know, I mean, so that was happening. It wasn't like it wasn't a thing. And yet Berman was notorious about not wanting to go there. And you brought up in the pre-show that there was only one episode you could think of.
I actually thought of a second one while we were talking just now. So in season three, and it's not quite an LGBT, but kind of, when Data created Lal, he allowed her to select her own race and gender. And so, again, it's sort of there, but not, but you know, guised as an android, to creation of an android, but it's still kind of there. But no, the one I was mentioning was called The Host, and it was a parasitic trill with no gender who was it season four no it was season five The Outcast. Will Riker has a relationship with one of the Genii, and the Genii is seeking asylum from her people because she doesn't want to be converted into a male. And while it's still a man and a woman, you know, Riker and a woman, the conversion therapy aspect of that episode was very real.
Yes.
That was all I could think of for Next Generation. I mean, if there's more, please check this out.
Other than other queer gay boys having a thing for Wesley Crusher, of which he's very happy that he found out there were gay boys who actually had a crush on Wesley Crusher. You know, that's one thing you can say about the actor, you know. Yeah. He's really pro about that. And so it was kind of cute that he was like, oh, he gushed over the fact that he found out gay boys back then had a thing for him. So.
Mm-hmm. So Deep Space Nine.
Deep Space Nine is the first moment where we really get queer representation in both the Cardassian and the Doctor.
Their relationship. Taylor.
Yeah. We get their burgeoning relationship sort of happening. It never comes fully to fruition. But
the actor who played Garak wanted it to.
Yes. Yes. And he definitely played to that.
Oh, yeah.
Alexander Siddig, who was the actor for the Doctor, Bashir, he knew where the line was and where to keep playing it. And they both put it. They did, you know. It was definitely something that they both worked on to try and do as much as they were allowed. But again, it was a Berman production, so there you go. So how did they go there? They went there with Jadzia Dax. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so you can't do the gay boys. But women is fine because, you know, straight men. That's what I thought when all of that was happening. I'm like, are you kidding me? Mm-hmm. This is how we're going. I mean, not that I'm complaining about a lesbian sequence, but my whole point was, you know, here we are, white, straight males gatekeeping, and they will allow a lesbian situation to happen because that's their fantasy. But screw us gay boys. Mm-hmm. So, and the thing is, you know, this is also where some of the queer backlash started to happen. Where it was all, why are we suddenly dealing with gay stories and blah, 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 blah. From people who professed to really embrace what Star Trek was all about, was inclusivity. And yet they had parameters. And it's like, okay, especially you people running around as Vulcans. You know, the whole idiot thing, come on, you know, you know. Mm-hmm. Infinite combinations. It's right there in the face, you know, the little symbol you guys wear on a necklace. It's right there, you know.
Yep.
And it's just, it's tragic because, you know, so many times, and you knew you had queer people working on the show, you know, both behind the scenes and, you know, obviously that were on the show, but it just never became a real thing until the reboot, headed by Brian Fuller, but we'll get to that in a second because we have Enterprise in between those. So we've gone from original series, which were in the late 60s, to Next Generation. And then we had Deep Space Nine, which kind of happened kind of three seasons in, and then Deep Space Nine premiered. And then we leap forward to the latter 90s when Enterprise entered the realm.
I know nothing happened on Voyager, but I feel like you're skipping Voyager.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I totally missed Voyager. Good point.
And the only reason I mention that is because, and I know we weren't talking about the books, but in the books, there's an ensign, Lieutenant Hawk, who's gay. And though he is played on the screen, he's not played as gay. So there's some fan quibbling about that. But where I'm going with this is Kate Mulgrew stood up to Rick Berman and asked where the gays were. Flat out asked him. Mm-hmm. To her credit and to the hero cape I would like to pin on her, asked for it, and it never materialized.
Yeah, because Rick Berman.
All right, now you can go on to Enterprise, which I didn't watch. I will preface this by saying.
You know, I loved Enterprise. I really did. But then again, you know, I like Captain Archer. I've always, he's, the actor's always been, what's his name? I can't think of his name now. You know, the actor Scott Bakula, he's, you know, always been an ally. He's been in other queer productions and such, and he has a musical background, you know, so he's done Broadway and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, I don't remember anything overtly being queer in Enterprise either. But then there's a part of me goes, wait a minute, there's something. So I'll have to go back and rewatch Enterprise to fully take it in. But I don't remember anything jumping out and imprinting on my mind at the time that, oh, we're here, you know, kind of thing. So, and Enterprise had a lot of pushback for a lot of reasons. It was a very different take on Star Trek. Even though it dealt with canon, it had its own production values. They were trying to do something unique and modern with it, from the fact that they even had actual pop song as the opening theme piece, sung by Russell Watson, who is a opera singer. They tried to mm-hmm. do something. They tried to get it to go in a different direction, and I give them E for effort for pushing in that direction. And I think, if I don't recall an episode where it was front and center, I'll go back and watch it, and I'll comment at some point on this episode and down in the comments if I do find an episode that has it where it's front and center, but it's just not gelling for me at the moment.
Or if you, the listeners and watchers, think of one.
If you guys can think of it.
Comment so other people can find it.
No. But, you know, I do think that Enterprise, and it's always funny. There are moments where some gay energy would float in a scene between two guys or something, and they never really made it the butt of a joke, but the sexual tension was there, and at least the characters sometimes questioned what they were feeling, you know? So we had that breadcrumb to deal with. But it wasn't until Brian Fuller, and for those of you who don't know who Brian Fuller is, he's an openly gay man. He's a director, producer, writer. He did Pushing Daisies, which had the fabulous queer actor Lee Pace in it. And he also did American Gods. That's another production of his.
Was Star Trek Beyond the J.J. Abrams before Fuller? And I ask because there's an important scene.
No, it actually came within when Fuller's started. The J.J. Abrams did do in the films, he did start to approach it, but we didn't really get it until Beyond.
Right.
The third
film. And in Beyond, we got to see the Sulu character hold hands with his husband and pick up their daughter.
And I thought it was interesting that was George Takei's failing moment, and he even walked back his original comment, was that he said, why can't you make another character gay instead of my character, even though at that time, back in the day, he had tried to get queer representation, and he was talking with Gene Roddenberry about doing that, and yet he responded that way about his character in this modern tale. And a number of actors and people who were involved in the production came back and said, one, it's the Kelvin timeline. Major difference here.
Yeah.
And then two, you know, you never really had that stuff within Sulu's character. There were allusions to his being heterosexual, but he could have been bisexual. You know, and so it was never established. You know, no matter what, yes, the assumption was made, but they did nothing, because back then Asians didn't have a sex life.
Right.
I mean, it's just how they were portrayed in the 60s.
You know, and part of me wonders if his initial reaction was because he did want to preserve all the good work that Roddenberry did do. And so he's trying to preserve a legacy. I'm not a telepath. I don't know.
It wasn't until these counter arguments came back that he revised his original critique. And said, no, you know, it can be what it is, because, you know, it is an alternate timeline. It is something different. And it was never established. I mean, the only thing you have is the Naked Truth sequence where he gets the stuff on and he goes kind of wild and runs around fencing and, you know, and then he tries to seduce Uhura, you know. So, you know, there's only that instance, and he was affected by a virus. So,
right.
You know, so, and I know a lot of people who aren't full Trek fans are going, boy, these guys are digging deep into shit. You know, I mean, it's important. You know, when I was a little boy, I was looking for that. And you know what? Here's the other thing too. And I was a member, a card-carrying member of the Leonard Nimoy fan club.
And you mentioned that, and I laughed.
And I would get big packets every month of what Leonard was up to. And interestingly enough, Leonard's own fan club in the... Because we used to get these binders of stuff. I mean, it was worth the money I spent on that thing. And in there would be actual pictures, hand-drawn pictures and stuff. And... stories shipping Spock and Kirk that were in those books.
Interesting.
Of course, there were the fans that were creating them, so it was like
it's
fanfic stuff in the fucking 70s. This is way back because I'm an old bitch, but so that it was in the way back years. So you understand that a little gay boy like me. Getting a package that Leonard Nimoy approved. He was active in his own fan club. It was also his official fan club.
Mm-hmm.
And we would get those packets. And, you know, there were some, I mean, they weren't salacious. Let's just put it that way.
Right.
But they were very tastefully done. So I don't want to put that out there. It wasn't like soft porn or anything like that. But the hint was definitely there. And it was front and center, and Leonard didn't have a problem with it. He was, you know, it was what it was, you know. So I loved that was how I got through those years, and how I felt mm-hmm. included was because I would receive something from the actor's fan club that sort of let me know I was okay.
Right.
You know.
Should we jump forward to Discovery?
Yeah. What are your initial thoughts?
Thank God. Finally.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Although, Stamets and that whole let's kill our gay and, Wilson Cruz had to fight really hard on Twitter and social media to say, no.
Stick with it. There's a reason.
Stay with us. We've got you. We have you. You know, we got your back. Don't worry. It will happen.
Mm-hmm.
And true to form, it did. You know, mm-hmm. And it was a necessary plot point because it put Shahad Latif's character, Ash Tyler, you know, it was a definite plot point that had to be played out
mm-hmm.
because his arc involved that very visceral moment
mm-hmm.
that got fans to really kind of buy into. I think it was a pivotal point in trying to get people to really embrace Stamets and...
Culber.
Oh yeah. Culber's, relationship.
Culber.
Yeah. To embrace their relationship because you really felt the dynamic and where things were going and how much Paul was spinning out without Hugh being there as his anchor.
Right.
Because Paul could literally touch with humanity very easily.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and he was well on his way.
Right. And Hugh was the thing that grounded him and kept him, which is how, we wanted to show in our relationships, that's how they work. You're in a couple, you play to each other's strengths, and you're there to back up some of their flaws or weaknesses. You're the one that catches them, in those situations. And when Paul Stamets lost that, he really started to spiral.
Yep.
And so we got some real honest to goodness realness in a relationship. And then when we get Hugh back, they struggled to put that back together again. It took a very heightened moment of potential loss that eventually reconnected them.
Yep. And now theirs is the most stable and normal relationship on the show.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I kind of liken it to the movie American Beauty, and stay with me, because the gays in that movie, which as fucked up as everybody is, and the characters in that movie, the only people that were Irma were the gay couple in the neighborhood.
That is true.
And I kind of, so when I saw this with Hugh and Paul, it's like, you know, this is cool because we're the ones that are not the drama in this, you know. I mean, they had their own drama, but it, you know, they weren't the ones spinning everybody else out, you know. Then we move to the
are you
other shows gonna, that are coming up.
Not going to talk about the new non-binary character, the young Trill?
Yeah, Discovery? We can definitely do that. Yeah, if we're going to talk about the show, yeah, so go ahead. What do you have?
I'm curious to see where they're going to go with him. I don't know at this point what their plan is for him. And if he's just there to be part of the world because it's part of the world, I support that 100%. So I'm just curious to see. I mean, he's kind of sort, they are kind of an adopted child of Stamets and Culber. So I'm curious to see how that develops.
And then now you have their partner.
Yeah.
You know, back in a android body. But that they're no longer have, because the story that was a trail that got placed inside Adira, and so the Adira was carrying her partner with them, and she could only see them, and so they found a way to extract that and have it become its own being again, and so that character was brought back to life, and well, through technology, you know, that kind of thing. So.
Thank goodness Picard got the android body first, so we could now use that throughout the rest of the Star Trek universe.
Exactly. Exactly. You know, so there was a lot of CYAing going on in the writer's room, I have to think.
Handwavium at its finest.
Anyways, so, you know, then you have, I have not watched Lower Decks. Have you watched it?
We tried and could not get into the sheer irreverent silliness of it.
Yeah, I wasn't really like a big, oh, can't wait. You know, I mean, I do like animation, so it's not an animation thing. It just seemed kind of gimmicky to me.
That's very much so. There's another animated one where Janeway plays the hologram on the ship.
That's not Lower Decks?
No, there's another one. It's geared slightly younger.
Oh, yeah. Why can't I think of it?
My husband's watched a couple episodes. He says it's actually really enjoyable. But it is a group of young aliens, mostly not friends, but acquaintances, who acquire a hidden experimental Federation ship and are fleeing from the guy who had stolen and hidden it. It's sort of the general plot. But Janeway is the holographic tutor who is coaching them on being a Starfleet crew. Excellent. And Mulgrew voices her. I've actually walked into a couple episodes while he's been watching them, and Mulgrew voices the hologram. So I'm glad to see her back in action.
I'll find out what the name of the show is, and I'll fly it here so people know what it is to look for. But I'm sure there are a lot of Trekkies out there going, it's this, damn it!
Yeah, but aside from the sentient goo-like creature who probably doesn't have a gender, I think, I can't tell at this point if the characters are geared to be young enough that it's not an issue yet.
Right.
So again, comment if you have better answers than me rambling here about something I haven't watched.
All right. So then we move on to Picard, which I don't remember anything completely jumping out at me about that.
What? Have you not caught up?
No, I've watched it all.
Do you know the kiss?
Oh! Sorry, brain fart. I'm old, kids.
Wow. Okay. The kiss that shook fandom, you have forgotten?
I didn't take my Nereva pill this morning.
So...
Yeah, the kiss. 7 of 9... You know what's weird? Why do they keep calling her seven instead?
That came up in Voyager. Janeway offered to call her Annika, her human name.
Right.
And she said it didn't always feel well, but she always has kind of like back and forth between the two names based on how she's felt about herself at the time. And so when she's feeling like she has to be emotionless to get a mission done, she veers into Call Me Seven. But when she's allowing herself to open up emotionally, she's Annika.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's
which
a cool
plays that whole gender identity thing.
It's a very much an identity thing.
Yeah. That's brilliant. I can't believe I let that one go. God, what an idiot.
I'm like, when you ask me, I'm like, you haven't seen the end of this last season, have you? No. And I'm sorry for everyone if we just spoiled it. I really am.
Catch up, people. Obviously, I didn't. I gotta go rewatch. Anyways, so obviously we're getting it now much more front and center. It is definitely in the realm of, you know, the shows now. And then with Strange New Worlds, we've got inklings. We've got some touchy-feely kind of connection moments happening. None of it is fully fleshed out. It's going to be really interesting to see where they go with it. But this is obviously a crew of producers and writers and directors that are being, that are carrying the inclusive torch forward. Mm-hmm. I am, like I've said before, I am totally down for Strange New Worlds. This is the one I've been wanting. I am thrilled to death with the fact that they're telling this part of the Trek universe. So definitely can't wait to see more of it.
And just to give you my personal take on the current series that are running, Discovery is very far future tech, and a lot of people are having a difficult time relating to it because they fell through a wormhole couple hundred years into the future. Oops. They went purposely to hide some tech, but it's hard to relate to that far future tech. And the crew is very isolated in time because they're from an early era, so they don't have friends.
Well, 900 years earlier.
Yeah. So they don't have friends and connections. So the problem is, though, that they still found the remnants of the Federation and are tied to that. So they're not on exploration. And my husband said it best when he said it felt like Deep Space Nine all over again, in that it was more politics than anything. Whereas Picard feels like, hey, we're going to try to get this band back together. Let's see how many of the old crew we can pull in and make do things for us. Dance, monkeys, dance, because everybody wants you back.
The only thing that bothers me about Picard is that now they've gotten rid of the Romulan. He's not going to be in season 3.
It's really? Elnor?
Confirmed. Yeah. Yeah.
I hadn't seen the confirmation. I knew that.
Yeah, he put out, Evan put out on his Instagram and stuff saying that, you know, his time at Picard was over. So I think he was the closest to that kind of representation because he had that softness and that naivete and
warrior boy raised by women.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think it's unfortunate we're never going to get any more of him because this next season's it and they're bringing the whole cast back. I'm like, why don't you just call it TNG 2.0? Because that's where we were going. You should have just done that from the beginning.
Bringing the cast back, bringing the band back together. So Strange New Worlds, though it covers a time period early in Enterprise's history, has also gotten back to the core original series in that they're boldly going out to explore.
Right. And I think it's probably more hewn to Roddenberry's original vision.
I think so, too. I think this is
the way he wanted to do it, but couldn't.
Right. I think we finally have reached a point where the full circle is where his dream was.
Right, right. For those who aren't Star Trek fans, but hey, maybe you like Star Wars and stuff, check out the latest offerings on Paramount Plus for the new Star Trek. They're going all in on the new Star Trek. There's even a new J.J. Abrams Star Trek that's being developed, number 4. Like to see where they're going to go without Chekhov, because we lost our dear beloved Anton Yelchin.
Yeah.
I think it would be, you know, interesting to see what they're going to do with the next movie. So I'm kind of interested in all of that. I like that cast of those three Abrams films. I've really gotten to really like that group of actors playing these characters.
Yes.
So we'll see how it plays out. I think it is interesting that hints that we've seen in social media of Paul Wesley playing Kirk, Jim Kirk, a young Jim Kirk. Mm-hmm. He looks close enough to Chris Pine that I thought, that's really interesting casting. Somebody was paying attention there.
All right, we've gone on quite long enough. What has won your week?
All right, so for mine, it's the whole thing. It's what are we on about and who won the week. And I'm springing something on Vance. I kind of told him I wanted him to see something. For people who don't know, this year
he's going to make me do a reaction video. Is what he's going
to
do.
Yeah, basically that's what it is. So for who won the week for me and what am I currently listening to? It's a song that won the Eurovision 2022. I watched it on YouTube, the winning performance, live performance, and it's great. It's really good. But unfortunately, unless you find the clip that actually has the subtitles, you don't know what the song is about. The song is Stefania, and it is by the Kalush Orchestra. And Kalush is actually a Ukrainian artist who has had pretty much a solo career, but I think he's now evolved it into this project that he's calling the Kalush Orchestra. And they are now rising. I mean, they've just, because they won this. And it's interesting because the video I'm going to show you is the official music video, but they didn't film it and produce it and put it out until after the contest was over because they didn't want to use what they were using as the backdrop, which is Ukraine in its current situation. Mm-hmm. They didn't want to use it as a political way of winning points. They wanted the song to stand on its own. So the song, interestingly enough, and I think this version has the subtitles that tell you what the song is. It is part what they're calling folk rap, in that it has a very strong Ukrainian feel. There are traditional Ukrainian instruments that are being played in it. It is, but not all, you know, they have electronica and all that kind of stuff that you typically have with rap music. And the Ukrainian, the rap part is spoken in Ukrainian as well. So it's all in Ukrainian, but the song is about how mothers are the heart of the family and how they're the ones who teach their boys and their children, you know, to rise up and to step forward into the world, but they still worry about their children no matter how old they grow. So the song is very poetic. It's very powerful when you actually understand what the song is about. So we're going to react to it now. I've seen it. I've watched it several times, but I just absolutely love it. So let me cue that up.
That was powerful.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I watched the, you know, it still makes me well up because it is just, I mean, to see these women fighting for their own country, to have to send their children away, to, you know, it's a very powerful story. And the fact that he wrote it about his mother, his grandmother, you know, the women in his family, and wanted to show his pride in how they raise their children and the sacrifices they make. And I just love the poetry in, you know, the fields are blooming, but your hair is turning gray, you know, time is passing, you know. I just loved how all of that just gels and the visuals, you know, because you look at it and you know that's not a fucking set. Mm-hmm. That's Ukraine right now, you know. And that's the part that I think gets to me the most, is seeing this juxtaposition of something that is honoring motherhood. And at the same time, you see the sacrifice on a level that most women don't have to do. And yet you're seeing this happen. So I wanted to share that with everybody because when I saw it, I was blown away. I was like, oh my God, this is one of the best songs ever put out there, because once you know the story, once you understand the words, it's probably one of the most powerful songs I've heard in a long, long time. So they're my who won, they're my who won the week, and they are also my what I'm listening to. So I've started to listen to some of other Kalusha's other stuff just to kind of get a feel for what he's saying. And he kind of does all of that kind of Ukrainian background. In fact, the guy who plays the flute, I think his name is Igor. That flute is a Ukrainian instrument, and the melody he plays, that he plays off of it, is a melody based on a melody that his grandmother used to play when he was little. Wow. So he's hearkening her stuff back into and weaving it into the song. So it's got this whole thing. And then the guy who plays the flute, he grew up learning how to play traditional Ukrainian instruments, not just the flute, but all the other ones too. So he has a real well-rounded education in Ukrainian music. And it just, you know, it was phenomenal for me. So that's who won the week, and that's what I'm listening to.
Nice. Well, I went a different direction, kind of, in that for me, the winner of the week is trying to save our planet so that we have a place for children to grow up. IKEA will start to sell solar panel kits this summer. Select stores in the U.S. first, but hopefully they will expand. But they're trying to make it accessible to everyone to start doing your part to save this environment, because we've all got to. That's all there is to it. Yep. So kudos to a big box retailer for trying to make it accessible to everyone.
Gotta love them Scandinavians.
I know, right?
They've got their shit together. Let me tell you, having been to Scandinavia, it is probably some of the most forward thinking. That whole area, you know, even up through the Balkans that are there, Estonia and the rest of them, they have so got it figured out. Oh my God, if Americans knew what was possible, they would crap themselves, because the Scandinavian and Balkan countries have figured it out. Especially Estonia and Finland, Sweden, Norway, and Denmark, they all have really figured out how to run a society, and it blows my mind. But anyway, that's excellent too. I love that. So kudos to the Scandinavians.
Right. All right. Well, we've run really long today, so folks, I will say right now that Written on the Edge is produced by Real Brave Moons Media. For our disclaimers, links to social media, our listen stations, or to sign up as a guest, visit www.roadpodcast.com. If you enjoy learning about new artists, please like and subscribe so you get the alerts for all the new episodes. And tune in next week for your queer media fix.
Bye.
Bye.
Closing time. The bums rush in melody, dear.